Hi everyone. So let us resume the session with the topaz assembler. We have discussed about the PASS1 algorithm in the previous session and what are the steps involved in the PASS1 assembler and how the assembler process the source program and how it generates the intermediate file that we discussed in the previous session. And now we move on to PASS2 of the two-pass assembler. After completing the PASS2, assembler generates the object program. So what is structure of the object program and how it will be creating the object program? That is what exactly we are going to discuss with this algorithm. So before moving on to the algorithm, let us view the structure or the format of object program. So this is the structure of the object program. So object program has three records: header record, text record, and end record. Each record will give you information about what is the content of that record and what for it is. See, for example, if you consider the header record, the first column H denotes it's a header record, and the second column onwards we have the program name, the starting address and the length of the program. As you could see in the PASS1 algorithm, at the end of the PASS1, the assembler is able to get the program length by subtracting the location counter by starting address. That gives you the program length. So the length of the object program in bytes, that is given in the last column of the header record. And what is the starting address, which is mentioned in the start of the program? That is also one of the component in header record. Apart from that, program name has to be mentioned in the header record. So the name of the program which is given in the previous example was copy. Let us move on to the next record, that is a text record. So text record is an important one in the object program where exactly the object code is stored. So T denotes a text record and starting address in this record. So why it has to be mentioned as in this record is, in the text record we are going to keep, we are going to have the object code. So the assembler, when it generates the object program, whatever the object code which has been generated by the assembler has to be kept or it has to be stored inside the text record. So if you have some 200 lines of code, so with the single text record, it is not possible to accommodate all the object code. That is the reason we'll have multiple text record. That's why it is mentioned as in this record, the starting address in this record, and the length of the object program in this record. So each and every record, since we have the multiple text record, in each text record, what is the starting address and how much we are going to keep. The length of the object code in the particular record. And after that, there will be object code. So probably there would be 10 instructions in a single text record is possible. Because as you could see, the column is 69 minus 10 plus 1, that gives you the value divided by 6. So finally, we'll be receiving the values 10. Okay, so why divided by 6 is because 6 digits we are keeping. Okay, 6 columns you are going to keep for each individual object code. Okay, so for each and every instruction, there is a 6 columns which is opted for object code. Okay, so that is why divided by 6 the value which gives you 10 instructions. So the 10 instructions can be accommodated in a single text record. That is the reason if you have 200 instructions, obviously there will be more number of text records you have. And coming to the end record, E denotes end record. And as I have already told you, when we have discussed about the source code, assembly language program, the last line end, that is opcode end, opcode which has the imperative end, that has the first executable instruction. Same way here, the assembler keeps the address of the first executable instruction. So that is the end of the program. Okay. So So these are the content of the object program. So when pass through is done with the object code program, it generated in this fashion. Okay, so let us move back to the pass through. This is the algorithm for pass through, and after pass through, during this process which is creating each record from the object program. So let's begin with the algorithm with begin keyword, and it is ending with end keyword. Read first input line, which is taken from the intermediate file. So assembler in the pass to, it reads the intermediate file, and it takes each individual lines from the intermediate file, and it has to be read, it has to be scanned, then it creates the object. If opcode is equal to start, then begin write listing line. So the information regarding the program that has to be there in the listing file, that is to be written, and read next input line, then end the begin statement for the if statement. Then after having this start assembler directive, we could make out what is the name of the program, what is the starting address of the program, all this informations we could make out, and probably from the pass one we could make out what is the length of the program also. So by having all this information, assembler is able to create the header record. That's how the next line, which shows that write header record to the object programs. As we could see, the object program contain header record, text record, and end record, and the assembler is creating the header record, so which is there in the part of the object program. So for the header record, the information required are the program name, what is starting address, and the length of the program. Then after header record, the text record has to be initialized. So that is why initialize first text record. Why it is saying first is because there might be multiple text records. While opcode not equal to end, do the same thing, as we could see the same kind of statements there in the pass one also, which were there in the pass one. Same thing which is followed in the pass two. While opcode not equal to end, begin, if this is not the command line, then we process the line. Begin search optable for opcode, as we have already used this optable in pass one. And we are going to use the same thing in pass two also. So assembler creates the symbol table, and which uses optable in pass one as well as in pass two. As you know already, in the optable contains the mnemonic and the machine equivalents, because the fundamental functions of the assembler already I have mentioned several times, that the first step is converting mnemonic into machine equivalent. That is the first function. The second function is assigning address to the labels. This is the second steps. So these two steps will be forming the object code. So for the first step, we need to know the value of the mnemonic, so that the assembler can derive from the optable. That's how it searches the optable for opcode. If found, then yes, it got the mnemonic, the corresponding machine equivalent for the mnemonic. So the next step would be, what is the address of the symbol it has to know, right? So for that, it has to move on. Now, once it founds the opcode in from the optable, if found, then begin. If that is a symbol in the operand field, so as you have already seen in the program, I have taken an example of STL and RETADR. This is one instruction which is available in the previous program. I have shown you in the previous session also. STL, RETADR. So STL, the value, corresponding value is 14, that has already found. Then RETADR, which is a symbol in the operand field. So if there is a symbol in the operand field, then what supposed to be done is search the symbol table for operand. So whenever there is a definition, symbol definition in the a program, so that symbol has to be added into the symbol table. That's what we have seen in the past one. So whenever there is a symbol in the label field, so the definition of the symbol we could identify and we store the symbol with the value. That's nothing but the location counter we stored already. That is actually we understood by seeing the symbol table, right? Okay, so the symbol table you could see like this. So you can see the RETADR 1033, and if you could see the first, it is having the value 1000, and the C loop it is having the value 1003, and so on. Okay, so the RETADR it's a symbol which is there in the label field during the pass one. So once it got the definition, then the value, corresponding value will be stored in the symbol table. So this box which shows the symbol table with the symbol and its value. Okay, so by referring the symbol table in pass 2, if the symbol appearing in operand field, then it has to search the symbol table for the operand. If it is found, if the entry is already available in the symbol table, as we could see the table structure of the symbol table I have shown you just now, we were able to find the value for RETADR. So the value is 1033. So store the symbol value as operand address. So we could make out what is the value for the RETADR. So this is how, which is done by the assembler. So how it is able to search the symbol table and it is able to find the or assign the address to the operand, that is how we could see from the table. So store the symbol value as operand address. Suppose if the assembler is not able to find the operand from the symbol table, then begin store 0 as the operand address, set error flag saying that undefined symbol. So if the symbol is not present in the symbol table, then obviously we assign 0 and we can say that it's an undefined symbol. I'll give you an example. If suppose you are using a variable A in your program, but you have not defined A in the beginning, int A in a C program, let us say. So what will happen? It will say undeclaration, not declared. So such kind of error if you will be getting at the time of compiling the program. Same way you could see here also, it says undefined symbol. So that is the end of the begin, and we end the for the symbol also. If there is no symbol in the operand field, it comes to the else part. Comes to the else part, storing 0 as the operand address. If none of the operand is there, then also it will put 0. If it is not able to find the symbol, then also it puts 0, but it says error. But if there is no operand at all in the instruction, and it is not a problem actually, it will be saying as 0 as the operand address, because there is nothing. So we got the mnemonic value, we got the symbol address, machine address, we got it. So the next step is assemble the instruction. That is what done by the assembler. So assemble the object code instruction. So now it is able to create the object code. If suppose apart from the instruction, suppose if the opcode is equal to byte, or if the opcode is equal to word, then convert constant into the object code. That is what I have shown you in the previous session. If it has the value 3, if it has the value 0, or if it has the value EOF, it is converted into corresponding values, numbers. So either it is an integer constant or a character constant, it converts into the numbers. So that is what happens, convert constant to the object code. If the object code is not fit into the current text record, then the text record has to be written into the object program and initialize the new text record. So this process will keep on happening. So add object code to the text record and write the listing line, read the next input line. So this process will be keep on going till the assembler founds the end. So once it reaches the end of the program, so writing the last text record, and it has to write the end record also. So write the last listing line as well. Okay. So it is able to create the object file as well as listing file. Whenever there is a, you know, hop code, whenever there is a byte, whenever there is a word, so the corresponding action has to be performed so that it will be creating the object code for the corresponding instructions. This is how it generates the object program from the source program. The whole process is about how the assembler converts source program into object program in two passes. Pass one and pass two, which has been described in the two different algorithms. So we'll see how the object program looks like. So once the source program is given, the source program, as I have already shown you, right? So this is the source program. So for the source program, if the source program is given to the assembler is going to generate the object program like this. So this is the example for the object program. You could see the header record, text record, and int record. So in the header record, the name of the program is copy, and the starting address is 1000, and the program length is 1078. So this is what the header record, and you can see the number of text record in the object program for the source, the corresponding source program, and you can see the end record also. So end record, which has the starting address, that is mentioned as 1000. So if you look at the text record contains the first text record contains the starting address and the length of the program, and followed by the object code. Okay, so this is the structure of the text record, as already we have seen in the structure of object program. So the text record contains starting address, length of the object code, and the object code. The same thing which is mentioned here also, the starting address, length, and object code. Now you can compare the text record information which corresponding to the source program. So if you take the first text record, the starting address. So starting address, as you could see, starting address is 1000. And the length of the object code in the first text record is 1E. 1E, which means that how many number of object code which are available in the particular text record. Okay, see, for example, if you take around 10 instruction, then length of the object code would be 1E. Okay, and followed by the object code. So if you could see the object code for the line number 10, the object code is 141033. The next object code is 482039, and the next object code is 001036, okay, and so on. Same thing you can make out from the values also. So you can see that 141033, then we have the values such as 482039 and 001036, and so on. So this how exactly you'll be able to find the object code inside the text record. So the entire thing is nothing but the object program. When you write the object program, so you should be knowing how when you write as an example the object program for the corresponding source program, you should be understanding how exactly the assembler is creating the object program for each and every instructions, and how it generates the object program with the different records like head record, text record, and the end record. Okay. So herein, if you look at the second text record, the second text record is starting in the location 101A. So 101A, which is there in the line number 60. So from that line onwards, the second text record starts. So if you could see from the line number 10 up to 55, all the object code values are available in the text record. So the line number 60, which is having the object code 0C1036, you can see the object code here in the second text record, 0C1036. Okay, so this how exactly this is being carried out. Okay, so same way for the third, fourth, and fifth text record also. So the length varies depending on how many object code we keep inside the text record. Based on that, the length of the text record also varies. So moving to the next topic, that is assembler design, in which we'll be having a very, very important topic, that is machine dependent assembler features. There are two features which are all depending on the machine. One is instruction format and addressing mode, and the other one is a program relocation. Okay, so what is about the instruction format and addressing mode, and what is program relocations? How the instruction formats and addressing modes are depending on the machine, so because of which what will happen? So what changes it makes or it gives in with respect to the object code, that is what exactly we'll be discussing in this concept. And one more very important topic is the program relocation, which is also depending on the machine. So these are the two topics under the machine dependent assembler features that we'll discuss in the next session.